momentum, impulse, conservation of momentum, soccer players must consider much information about the ball and their own bodies in order to play effectively. The player in the photograph determines what force to exert on the ball in order to send the ball where he wants it to go. Soccer is a good example to help students understand the concept of momentum and distinguish it from force, velocity, and kinetic energy. This photograph is a dramatic example of a player colliding with a ball and changing the momentum of the ball. Use this example to illustrate the vector nature of momentum. The photograph can open up a discussion about how the direction as well as the magnitude of direction is affected by the collision. The overview of Chapter 6, Momentum and Impulse, defines momentum in terms of mass and velocity, introduces the concept of impulse, and relates impulse and momentum. Conservation of momentum explores the law of conservation of momentum and uses this law to predict the final velocity of an object after a collision. Section 3, Elastic and Inelastic Collisions, distinguishes between elastic, perfectly inelastic, and inelastic collisions and discusses whether kinetic energy is conserved in each type of collision. Knowledge to review. A force on an object is a push or pull that tends to cause a change in motion. Forces can be field or contact forces. Newton's laws of motion describe the effects of forces on objects and the idea that forces always exist in pairs. Energy of motion, called kinetic energy, depends on mass and speed. Kinetic energy equals 1/2 mass times velocity squared. Energy is neither created nor destroyed, but it can be converted from one form to another. Items to probe. Newton's third law, have students draw free body diagrams for interacting objects and identify the third law pairs. Chapter preview. The first section is called Momentum and Impulse, and that's broken into a subsection and solely called Linear Momentum. Section 2, Conservation of Momentum, is entirely momentum is conserved. Elastic and inelastic collisions is broken into two subsections, collisions and elastic collisions. In this chapter, you will analyze momentum and collisions between two or more objects. You will consider the mass and velocity of one or more objects and the conservation of momentum and energy. Collisions and other transfers of momentum occur frequently in everyday life. Examples in sports include the motion of balls against rackets in tennis and the motion of human bodies against each other in football. That would be American football, I'm sure they're talking about, not European or world football. Section 1, Momentum and Impulse. The objectives, there are four. Compare the momentum of different moving objects. Compare the momentum of the same object moving with different velocities. The third one is identify examples of change in momentum of an object. And number 4, describe changes in momentum in terms of force and time. Linear momentum. When a soccer player heads a moving ball during a game, the ball's velocity changes rapidly. After the ball is struck, the ball's speed and the direction of the ball's motion change. The ball moves across the soccer field with a different speed than it had and in a different direction than it was traveling before the collision. The quantities and kinematic equations describing one-dimensional motion predict the motion of the ball before and after the ball is struck. The concept of force and Newton's laws can be used to calculate how the motion of the ball changes when the ball is struck. In this chapter, we will examine how the force and duration of the collision between the ball and the soccer player affect the motion of the ball. Momentum is mass times velocity. To address such issues, we need a new concept. And we call this concept momentum, a quantity defined as the product of the mass and velocity of an object. Momentum is a word we use every day in a variety of situations. In physics, this word has a very, very specific meaning. The linear momentum of an object of mass, m, moving with velocity, v, is defined as the product of the mass and the velocity. Momentum is represented by the symbol p. Momentum. P equals mv. Momentum equals mass times velocity. As its definition shows, momentum is a vector quantity with its direction matching that of the velocity. Momentum has dimensions, mass times length over time, and its SI units are kilogram meters per second, or kgm over s. If you think about some examples of the way the word momentum is used in everyday speech, you will see that the physics definition conveys a similar meaning. Imagine coasting down a hill of uniform slope on your bike without pedaling or using brakes. Because of the force of gravity, you will accelerate. That is, your velocity will increase with time. This idea is often expressed by saying that you are picking up speed or gathering momentum. The faster you move, the more momentum you have, and the more difficult it is to come to a stop. Did you know momentum is so fundamental in Newton's mechanics that Newton called it simply quantity of motion? The symbol of momentum, P, comes from German mathematician Gottfried Leibniz. Leibniz used the term progress to mean the quantity of motion with which a body proceeds in a certain direction. Imagine rolling a bowling ball down one lane at a bowling alley and rolling a playground ball down another lane at the same speed. The more massive bowling ball exerts more force on the pins than the playground ball exerts because the bowling ball has more momentum than the playground ball does. When we think of a massive object moving at a high velocity, we often say that the object has a large momentum. The less massive object with the same velocity has a smaller momentum. On the other hand, a small object moving with a very high velocity may have a larger momentum than a more massive object that is moving slowly does. For example, small hailstones falling from very high clouds can have enough momentum to hurt you or cause serious damage to cars or even buildings. A bicycle rolling downhill has momentum. An increase in either mass or speed will increase the momentum. A 2,250 kilogram pickup truck has a velocity of 25 meters per second east. What is the momentum of the truck? This is given the mass of the truck, the velocity of the truck, 25 meters per second east, and we want to find the momentum. Well, the momentum is going to simply be the product of the mass times the velocity. So in your calculator, you would put 2250 times 25, and your answer will be east, because the vector quantity for the velocity says east, so your answer would actually be east. So it would be 5.6 times 10 to the 4th kilogram meters per second east. I left off the east, but it should be there. Momentum is a vector quantity, so you must specify both its size and direction. So it would be east. And remember, that momentum stays constant as long as the velocity stays constant and the mass doesn't change. A deer with a mass of 146 kilograms is running head-on toward you with a speed of 17 meters per second. You are going north. Find the momentum of the deer. So the mass is 146 kilograms, and it's going 17 meters per second south because it's running at you and you're going north. So it's going to be 146 times 17 meters per second south, and you would multiply the two values, and you would get 17 times 146 on your calculator, which is 2.5 times 10 to the third kilogram meters per second to the south. And remember, that momentum is constant as long as you are moving at a constant velocity. A 21 kilogram child on a 5.9 kilogram bike is riding with a velocity of 4.5 meters per second to the northwest. What is the total momentum of the child and the bike together? Well, the mass one is 21 kilograms, that's the child. The bike is 5.9 kilograms, and the velocity is 4.5 meters per second northwest. So that's the total momentum is going to be your total mass times the velocity because they're together. So the total momentum of everyone together, the bike and the child, will be 21 plus 5.9, that quantity, times 4.5 meters per second. And your total velocity, your total mass will be 27 kilograms. You're going to round it, of course. And then times 4.5, and your answer will be 1.2 times 10 to the 2 kilogram meters per second northwest. Now remember, when they say northwest, that's 45 degrees, as opposed to north of west. What is the momentum of the child? If you were just going to look at the child alone, what would be the momentum of the child apart from the bike? So you set up your equation, and it's simply going to be M1, which is going to be the momentum of the child, times the mass of the child, times the velocity. So you'll plug into the equation 21 kilograms, which is the mass of the child, times 4.5 meters per second, is going to be, in your calculator, when you plug in, 94 kilograms meters per second northwest. That will be the momentum and direction. What is the momentum of the bike? Well, it would be your P sub 2 will equal your M sub 2, where the 2 refers to the bike. And then you would multiply 5.9 times 4.5 meters per second northwest. And your answer will be, when you plug in, let's plug into the equation first, and your answer is 5.9 times 4.5, so 6 times 4 is 24, so 27 kilogram meters per second northwest. That sounds right. If you got something like 280, you would know that that would be wrong. What velocity must a 1,210 kilogram car have in order to have the same momentum as the pickup truck in sample problem A? So you have your mass is 1,210, your momentum, because it has the same momentum of the sample problem A, which is 5.6 times 10 to the fourth kilogram meters per second, you're going to solve the velocity. What's the velocity going to be? So V equals P over M. So it will be 5.6 times 10 to the fourth divided by 1,210 kilograms, and it will be 46 meters per second east. So remember, I said, if the momentum is constant, it's constant. So if you're going to apply a momentum to a particular object and you reduce the mass, you're going to increase the velocity. When the ball is moving very fast, the player must exert a large force over a short time to change the ball's momentum and quickly bring the ball to a stop. A change in momentum takes force and time. Figure 2 shows a player stopping a moving soccer ball. In a given time interval, he must exert more force to stop a fastball than to stop a ball moving more slowly. Now imagine a toy truck and a real dump truck rolling across a smooth surface with the same velocity. It would take much more force to stop the massive dump truck than to stop the toy truck in the same time interval. You have probably also noticed that a ball moving very fast stings your hands when you try to catch it. The fastball stings because it exerts more force on your hands than the slow-moving ball does. From examples like these, we can see that a change in momentum is closely related to force. In fact, when Newton first expressed his second law mathematically, he wrote it not as F equals ma, but in the following form. F equals the change in momentum divided by the time interval, or force equals change of momentum over time interval. F equals delta P over delta T. That's the form he wrote it. He did not write it as F equals ma initially. We can arrange this equation to find the change in momentum in terms of the net external force and the time interval required to make this change. Impulse momentum theorem, F times delta T equals delta P equals m times v sub f minus m v sub I. Force times time interval equals change in momentum. So you can factor the mass out of the equation as long as they're the same mass. In simple terms, a small force acting for a long time can produce the same change in momentum as a large force acting for a short time. In this book, all forces exerted on an object are assumed to be constant unless otherwise stated. The expression F delta T equals delta P is called the impulse momentum theorem. The term on the left side of the equation, F delta T, is called the impulse of the force F for the time interval delta T. Impulse is defined as the product of the force and the time over which the force acts on an object. The equation F delta T equals delta P explains why proper technique is important in many sports, from karate and billiards to softball and croquet. For example, when a batter hits a ball, the ball will experience a greater change in momentum if the batter keeps the bat in contact with the ball for a longer time. Extending the time interval over which a constant force is applied allows a small force to cause a greater change in momentum than would result if the force were applied for a very short time. You may have noticed this fact when pushing a full shopping cart or moving furniture. Force and impulse, sample problem B. A 1,400 kilogram car moving westward with a velocity of 15 meters per second collides with a utility pole and is brought to a rest in 0.3 seconds. Find the force exerted on the car during the collision. Well, that's what's given. And so I need my impulse momentum theorem equation, which allows me to find the force given the mass and velocity and the change, etc. So now what I can do is I can look again to see what my givens are. Let me just say something about the equations before we begin. It says F delta T equals delta P. Now delta P is the change in momentum. There's a difference between the change in momentum and the momentum itself. You don't notice momentum unless you have a change, and that change is the change in velocity. The mass is going to stay the same in this case. So your VF minus your VI will cause the change in the momentum. So you ultimately have F equals MVF minus MVI over delta T. So now you want to use this equation and to plug in to your original values. So I'm going to factor out the m, the mass, because it's the same for both, and I'm going to plug in my values. Now, it's going from, you know, it's going to, I mean, part of the problem is that, of the accident, is that the final velocity is going to be zero. That's part of the problem. So that part is simplified by the zero for the final velocity. So here are my values that are given, plugged in. Notice the zero velocity for V sub F. And then I'm going to run these through a calculator and calculate. Create a simple convention for describing the direction of vectors. For example, always use a negative speed for objects moving west or south, and a positive speed for objects moving east or north. Because remember, the momentum is still a vector quantity. So I'm going to have a force of 70,000 newtons east, which is quite a large force. If you weigh 100 kilograms, your weight is approximately 1,000 newtons. So 70,000 newtons is 70 G, 70 times the effective gravity. So that's going to be a serious accident. A 0.50 kilogram football is thrown with a velocity of 15 meters per second to the right. A stationary receiver catches the ball and brings it to rest in 0.02 seconds. What is the force exerted on the ball by the receiver? So that's my given. And now I'm going to set my equation for impulses on the left, change in momentum on the right. And I'm going to plug in my values. I could factor out my mass, but it doesn't matter as long as you have a calculator. And I have 380 newtons, negative 380 to the right or positive 380 to the left. A 82 kilogram man drops from rest on a diving board 3 meters above the surface of the water and comes to rest 0.55 seconds after reaching the water. What is the net force on the diver as he is brought to rest? That's my given. And now I have to use a kinematic equation to get the final velocity. I'm not given the final velocity, as you'll notice. I'm not given final velocity. So I have to calculate the final velocity given my acceleration and distance and initial velocity. So set up just like we did in chapter 2, take the square root, and you get negative 7.7 meters per second. Now you're going to put that over to the side, and now you're going to use the final velocity of negative 7.7 meters per second in order to calculate the next part of the problem, which says, what is the net force on it? So you have the delta T, and you can calculate now, because you have the final velocity, the change in momentum. So correct and solve for F, and you get 1148 newtons. A 0.40 kilogram soccer ball approaches a player horizontally with a velocity of 18 meters per second to the north. The player strikes the ball and causes it to move in the opposite direction with a velocity of 22 meters per second. What impulse was delivered to the ball by the player? So think about what you have and what you need. You want the impulse, which is the change in momentum or the force times time. So you're given all of the different velocities that you're going to need in order to do this. So the impulse is going to be the change in momentum, which is 16 kilogram meters per second south. A 0.5 kilogram object is at rest. A 3 newton force to the right acts on the object during a time interval of 1.5 seconds. What is the velocity of the object at the end of this time interval? At the end of the interval, at the end of the 1.5 seconds, what is the velocity? So you've got to come up with a final velocity. So here's the equation, and you want to solve for the final velocity. So you simply isolate the final velocity. You're going to plug in, and you're going to solve. So it's going to be plus 9 meters per second. At the end of this interval, a force of 4 newtons to the left is applied for 3 seconds. What is the velocity at the end of 3 seconds? So the velocity will change because of the force, according to Newton's second law. So here's the equation, and this is my equation. I'm going to calculate VF2 given that force, and you're going to plug in, and you'll solve. See, the plus 9 meters per second is plugged in. That's what I had. So it's going to be negative 9.0 meters per second as the VF2. Now, here is figure 3. The loaded truck must undergo a greater change in momentum in order to stop than the truck without a load. So there are the stopping distances. One has no load. One has a load. So keep that in mind, because we're going to do a figure analysis on figure 3. It says, be sure students understand the relationship between stopping time and momentum. Right. Stopping time and force are inversely proportionate, or time and change of momentum are proportionate. Force and momentum are proportionate. Question 1, why is the loaded truck stopping time twice as much as the empty trucks when acted on by the same force? The loaded truck's momentum must be twice as large as the unloaded truck, so its change of momentum is also twice as large. Assuming that the applied forces are the same, the time period must be twice as large, because delta P equals F delta T. So question 2 is going to be, how do the stopping distances of the trucks compare? So how's the distance change as a result of this? Well, you can look at the kinematic equations. It says the loaded truck's time period is twice as large while its acceleration is half as much, because x equals vi delta t plus 1/2 acceleration delta t squared. The loaded truck stopping distance is 2 times as large as the empty trucks. The braking force is assumed to be the same in both cases. Stopping times and distances depend on the impulse momentum theorem. Highway safety engineers use the impulse momentum theorem to determine stopping distances and safe following distances for cars and trucks. For example, the truck hauling a load of bricks in figure 3 has twice the mass of the other truck, which has no load. Therefore, if both are traveling at 84 kilometers per hour, the loaded truck has twice as much momentum as the unloaded truck. If we assume that the brakes on each truck exert about the same force, we find that the stopping time is 2 times longer for the loaded truck than for the unloaded truck. And the stopping distances for the loaded truck is 2 times greater than the stopping distances for the truck without a load. A 2240 kilogram car traveling to the west slows down uniformly from 20 meters per second to 5 meters per second. How long does it take the car to decelerate if the force on the car is 8,410 newtons to the east? How far does the car travel during the deceleration? Okay, this is going to be a little bit complicated. I have my initial and final velocities. I have my force. Notice the direction of the velocities relative to the relative to the problem. I want to know the delta t as well as the delta x, because it says how far does the car travel during the acceleration. So let's break out the formulas. Let's try to figure out, based on the formulas we have, how we might do the problem. So here's the change in momentum equals the impulse. So I know I have everything I need to find the time. So that's easy. I can just plug in. Again, when you're choosing an equation, find out what you have, find out what you need, and then just go through a checklist. One variable, you need one thing, so that's all you need. And so my time is going to be calculated using the equation, and I'm going to plug into that and do my delta t. And then you want to say, well, how far do you need to go? Well, do I have a kinematic equation which relates time and distance? And that's the one, if you have velocity, of course. So I can then utilize this equation. I have VI and VF, and multiply it by the delta T I found, and I get negative 50 meters, or 50 meters west. For motion in one dimension, take special care to set up the sign of the speed. You can then treat the vectors in the equations of motion as scalars and add direction at the end. So, you know, when you're doing it mathematically, you can sometimes just forget the signs and add them on later. How long would the car in sample problem C take to come to a stop from an initial velocity of 20 meters per second to the west? How far would the car move before stopping, assume a constant acceleration? So there's my mass, change in velocities, and force. And there's my equations. Fairly straightforward. My change in time is easy. You can look at, see the basic equations, and you can calculate time. You have everything else you need. So you're going to plug in and grind it out. 5.33 seconds. You put that off to the side. Now you're going to use your distance equation and plug into that. And you will get negative 53.3 meters as the distance. A 2,500 kilogram car traveling to the north is slowed down uniformly from an initial velocity of 20 meters per second by a 6,250 Newton braking force acting opposite the car's motion. Use the impulse momentum theorem to answer the following questions. What is the car's velocity after 2.5 seconds? So I'm going to plug into the formula. I have everything in that formula, but the car's final velocity after 2.5 seconds, so I can solve for final velocity, and that's it. Now plug in and crank it out, and thank your stars that you have a calculator. Makes things so much easier. And you get plus 13.8 meters per second north. So put that into the side, and now how far does the car move during the 2.50 seconds? So now what you're going to do is you're going to use the kinematic equation that utilizes time and velocities, initial and final, and you're going to simply plug in and calculate that value. So I use parentheses there because it's just easier to plug in my values. It looks cleaner. So I'm going to put that in the calculator. I'm going to get plus 42 meters north. Now, C says, how long does it take the car to come to a complete stop? So you have your final velocity at 13.8 meters per second that you're going to plug in there. So now you want to calculate the time. So you're going to utilize that equation, which has change in momentum and impulse, and you're going to plug everything in, and you're going to recognize that it's asking relative to a complete stop. So your V final is zero, and your initial was 20 meters per second, so it's going to be 8 seconds. The V final was the answer to a preceding example, 13.8 meters per second. So this is to come to a complete stop. Assume that the car in sample problem C has a mass of 3,250 kilograms. How much force would be required to cause the same acceleration as in item one? Use the impulse momentum theorem. Well, it's telling you what equation to use, which is very helpful. That's what I have. That's what, you see the new mass there, 3,250. So you're going to simply plug in the new data, and you're going to, new data and old data, and you're going to simply calculate the force, which is plus 12,200 newtons north. How far would the car move before stopping? Use the force found in A. There's my distance equation. So you're going to plug the data into that, and you're going to come up with an expression, and you're going to calculate it, and it's going to come into negative 53.3 meters. Figure four, in this game, the girl is protected from injury because the blanket reduces the force of the collision by allowing it to take place over a longer time interval. You can do the same thing with an egg. The egg's not going to break. Force is reduced when the time interval of an impact is increased. The impulse momentum theorem is used to design safety equipment that reduces the force exerted on the human body during collisions. Examples of this are the nets and giant air mattresses firefighters use to catch people who must jump out of tall burning buildings. The relationship is also used to design sports equipment and games. Figure four shows an Inupiat family playing a traditional game. Common sense tells us that it is much better for the girl to fall onto the outstretched blanket than onto the hard ground. In both cases, however, the change in momentum of the falling girl is exactly the same. The difference is that the blanket gives way and extends the time of collision so that the change in the girl's momentum occurs over a longer time period. A longer time interval requires a smaller force to achieve the same change in the girl's momentum. Therefore, the force exerted on the girl when she lands on the outstretched blanket is less than the force would be if she were to land on the ground. Figure 5, a large force exerted over a short time, A, causes the same change in the egg's momentum as a small force exerted over a longer time, as in B. One results in the breakage, larger force. One results in no breakage, smaller force. Now consider a falling egg. When the egg hits a hard surface, like the plate in Figure 5A, the egg comes to rest in a very short time interval. The force the hard plate exerts on the egg due to the collision is large. When the egg hits the floor covered with a pillow, as in Figure 5B, the egg undergoes the same change in momentum, but over a longer time interval. In this case, the force required to accelerate the egg to rest is much smaller. By applying a small force to the egg over a longer time interval, the pillow causes the same change in the egg's momentum as the hard plate, which applies a larger force over a shorter time interval. Because the force in the second situation is smaller, the egg can withstand it without breaking. Section review. 1. the speed of a particle is doubled, by what factor is the momentum changed? The speed of the particle is doubled. So the momentum would increase by a factor of 2. So it's directly proportional. What happens to its kinetic energy if the speed is doubled? Well, it's 1/2 mv². So if I double 2, what do I do to the outcome of it? Well, it's quadrupled. So kinetic energy by a factor of 4. A pitcher claims that he can throw a 0.145 kilogram baseball with as much momentum as a speeding bullet. Assume that a 3-gram bullet moves at a speed of 1.50 times 10 to the third meters per second, 1,500 meters per second. What must the baseball speed be if the pitcher's claim is valid? So that's what I have. It's actually a fairly simple calculation, and I'm calculating V1, which is the speed of the baseball. So it's got to be 31 meters per second. Now you want to look up if that's a reasonable speed based on your experience. Do you use kilometers per hour or miles per hour? You have to do the conversion. Which has greater kinetic energy, the ball or the bullet? So mass times velocity squared. So it gives you the idea that the bullet is going to have a much greater, because that's squared, a squared quantity. So the ball has a kinetic energy of 70 joules, yet the bullet is 3,375 joules, much greater. So the bullet has a greater kinetic energy by quite a bit, actually. So when it's that velocity that really is the determining factor. When you square the number, that's really what gives you the much higher kinetic energy. A 0.42 kilogram soccer ball is moving downfield with a velocity of 12 meters per second. A player kicks the ball so that it has a final velocity of 18 meters per second downfield. What is the change in the ball's momentum? So be advised that it's going 12 meters per second downfield, and you're going to increase the speed to 18 meters per second. So it's going to be an increase in speed. So the change in momentum is going to be 2.52 kilogram meters per second. Find the constant force exerted by the player's foot on the ball if the two are in contact for 0.02 seconds. So I know the change in momentum to increase it to that velocity. So, and then I'm simply going to divide that by the time, and my force is going to be 126 newtons downfield. When a force is exerted on an object, does a large force always produce a larger change in the object's momentum than a smaller force does? Aha, as they say when the plot's about to thicken. Aha. No, because delta P equals F delta T, it is possible for a large force applied over a short time interval to change the momentum less than a smaller force applied over a longer time. What is the relationship between impulse and momentum? Well, impulse is equal to the change in momentum. So that's the big thing. You have to make sure that you have a change in momentum. It's not equal to simply momentum. It's only equal to a change in momentum. Impulse is equal to the change in momentum. That's a not so subtle point. Make sure you understand that it's a change in momentum. Section 2, conservation of momentum. Describe the interaction between two objects in terms of the change in momentum of each object. Compare the total momentum of two objects before and after they interact. State the law of conservation of momentum and predict the final velocities of objects after collision given the initial velocities. So here we have table one, momentum in a collision, and it kind of tries to get you to understand the point of the conservation of momentum. When is momentum conserved? When is it not conserved? The difference between elastic and inelastic collisions. A, before the collision, the momentum of ball A is P, and of ball B is zero. B, during the collision, ball A loses momentum, and ball B gains momentum. C, after the collision, ball B has momentum, P, sub B, final. So far in this chapter, we have considered the momentum of only one object at a time. Now we will consider the momentum of two or more objects interacting with each other. Figure 6 shows a stationary billiard ball set into motion by a collision with a moving billiard ball. Assume that both balls are on a smooth table and that neither ball rotates before or after the collision. Before the collision, the momentum of ball B is equal to zero because the ball is stationary. During the collision, ball B gains momentum while ball A loses momentum. The momentum that ball A loses is exactly equal to the momentum that ball B gains. Table 1 shows the velocity and momentum of each billiard ball both before and after the collision. The momentum of each ball changes due to the collision, but the total momentum of the two balls together remains constant. In other words, the momentum of ball A plus the momentum of ball B before the collision is exactly equal to the momentum of ball A plus the momentum of ball B after the collision, or P sub A initial plus P sub B initial equals P sub A final plus P sub B final. This relationship is true for all interactions between isolated objects and is known as the law of conservation of momentum. Conservation of momentum. M1 times V1 initial plus M2 V2 initial equals M1 V1 final plus M2 V2 final, or total initial momentum equals total final momentum. For an isolated system, the law of conservation of momentum can be stated as follows. The total momentum of all objects interacting with one another remains constant regardless of the nature of the forces between the objects. Momentum is conserved in collisions. In the billiard ball example, we found that the momentum of ball A does not remain constant and the momentum of ball B does not remain constant, but the total momentum of ball A and ball B does remain constant. In general, the total momentum remains constant for a system of objects that interact with one another. In this case, in which the table is assumed to be frictionless, the billiard balls are the only two objects interacting. If a third object exerted a force on either ball A or ball B during the collision, the total momentum of ball A and B and the third object would remain constant. In this book, most conservation of momentum problems deal with only two isolated objects. However, when you use conservation of momentum to solve a problem or investigate a situation, it is important to include all objects that are involved in the interaction. frictional forces, such as the frictional force between the two billiard balls and the table, will be disregarded in most conservation of momentum problems in this book. Momentum is conserved for objects pushing away from each other. Another example of conservation of momentum occurs when two or more interacting objects that initially have no momentum begin moving away from each other. Imagine that you initially stand at rest and then jump up, leaving the ground with a velocity of V. Conceptual challenge, ice skating. If a reckless ice skater collides with another skater who is standing on the ice, is it possible for both skaters to be at rest after the collision? And space travel, a spacecraft undergoes a change of velocity when its rockets are fired. How does the spacecraft change velocity in empty space, where there is nothing for the gases emitted by the rockets to push against? Well, that's a common question that scientists didn't really know before the advent of space travel. They didn't know what the answer was. We think of the answer today as being almost common sense, but back then, in the 1950s, people didn't know. It was a strange question that scientists did not agree on. Ice skating. No, the only possible way for their final total momentum to be zero is if the initial total momentum is also zero. This could happen only if both skaters initially have the same magnitude of momentum, but in opposite directions. Space travel. The principle of conservation of momentum tells us that the momentum of the spacecraft and its fuel before the rockets are fired must equal the momentum of the two after the rockets are fired. Both begin at rest, so the total initial momentum is zero. When the rockets are fired, the combustion of the fuel gives the exhaust gases momentum. The spacecraft will gain a momentum equal in magnitude, but opposite in direction to the exhaust gases. Thus, the total momentum will be kept at zero. You can look at it in another way as to whether or not you can do it by saying Newton's third law, and you have action, reaction. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. And we'll discuss that in class to a greater degree. Obviously, your momentum is not conserved. Before the jump, it was zero, and it became mv, or mass times velocity, as you began to rise. However, the total momentum remains constant if you include Earth in your analysis. The total momentum for you and Earth remains constant. If your momentum after you jump is 60 kilogram meters per second upward, then Earth must have a corresponding momentum of 60 kilogram meters per second downward, because total momentum is conserved. Some students may think that the principle of conservation of momentum applies only to collisions. Use the examples of two skaters in Figure 7 to show that the law holds even when the initial momentum is zero. A. When the skaters stand facing each other, both skaters have zero momentum, so the total momentum of both skaters is zero. B. When the skaters push away from each other, their momentum is equal but opposite, so the total momentum is still zero. However, because Earth has an enormous mass of 6 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, its momentum corresponds to a tiny velocity, 1 times 10 to the negative 23rd meters per second. Imagine two skaters pushing away from each other, as shown in Figure 7. The skaters are both initially at rest with a momentum of zero. When they push away from each other, they move in opposite directions with equal but opposite momentum, so that the total final momentum is also zero. Notice the subscripts for the momentum. Let's take a break and look at surviving a collision. Pucks and carts collide in physics labs all the time with little damage. But when cars collide on a freeway, the resulting rapid change in velocity can cause injury or death to the drivers and any passengers. Look at this car. It hit a pole. Its stopping time was very short. A teacher has told how she cheated death when her car was horrifically crushed beyond recognition between two lorries. That's a true story, and that's the picture from it. Many types of collisions are dangerous, but head-on collisions involving the greatest accelerations and thus the greatest forces. When two cars going 100 kilometers per hour, 62 miles per hour, collide head-on, each car dissipates the same amount of kinetic energy that it would dissipate if it hit the ground after being dropped from the roof of a 12-story building. Can you imagine? The changes in momentum can be absolutely tremendous, and it's tied to time and force. U.S. couple and daughter killed in New Zealand car crash, Perks said, the son was in the passenger seat and the couple was in the rear of the car. She said an initial scene examination indicated the parents were not wearing seatbelts. The truck driver was not injured in the crash, police said, who are continuing to investigate. That is a true story from the internet. The key to many automobile safety features is the concept of impulse. One way today's cars make use of the concept of impulse is by crumpling during impact. Pliable sheets of metal and frame structures absorb energy until the force reaches the passenger compartment, which is built of rigid. Here's an example of multiple airbags. You have the front airbags, you have side airbags, and again, it works on the principle of impulse. The greater the time, the lower the force. So they help in that way. Crumple zones, airbags, seatbelts. Because the crumpling slows the car gradually, it is an important factor in keeping the driver alive. Even taking into account this built-in safety feature, the National Safety Council estimates that high-speed collisions involve accelerations of 20 times freefall acceleration. Here's an illustration that looks at the deployment of an airbag from the electrical charge that's produced at the crash sensor to the explosion, literal explosion, and production of nitrogen gas from sodium azide, which is NaN3. In other words, an 89-newton, 20-pound infant could experience a force of 1,780 newtons, which is 400 pounds, in a high-speed collision. Seatbelts are necessary to protect the body from forces of such large magnitude. They stretch and extend the time it takes a passenger's body to stop, thereby reducing the force on the person. Here are modern crumple zones. Airbags further extend the time over which the momentum of a passenger changes, decreasing the force even more. As of 1998, all new cars have airbags, both the driver and the passenger side. Seatbelts also prevent passengers from hitting the inside frame of the car. We didn't have seatbelts in our car until the mid-1960s. And the dashboards also were not padded. We had no seatbelts. We had no padded dash. We had no airbags. We had no crumple zones. We had nothing. There were giant, giant tanks that went 60, 70 miles an hour. During a collision, a person not wearing a seatbelt is likely to hit the windshield, the steering wheel, or the dashboard, often with traumatic results. Seatbelts increase your chance of surviving a collision almost 50%. When I worked as an EMT, emergency medical technician, on road accidents and giving first aid, sometimes the crashes were horrific. And the more modern the car was, and the more they wore seatbelts, the more likely was the passengers survived, in some cases unscathed, even though it could have been a traumatic accident. A 76-kilogram boater, initially at rest in a stationary 45-kilogram boat, steps out of the boat and onto the dock. If the boater moves out of the boat with a velocity of 2.5 meters per second to the right, what is the final velocity of the boat? Well, there are my masses. Notice that V1, the boater in the boat, V1, V2 initial are zero. That's going to be important in setting up the equation. I'm going to be looking for V2 final, which is going to be of the boat. So here's the diagram. Look at M1 is the boater, M2 is the boat, and V1F is 2.5, that's the boater, and I've got to find, so you know intuitively, that the boat is going to be going to the left. So if the boat's going to the left and the boater's going to the right, that's going to help me understand the signs. Because the total momentum of an isolated system remains constant, the total initial momentum of the boater and the boat will be equal to the total final momentum of the boater and the boat. Now, because the initial momentum of both are zero, the left side of the equation is zero. So I can set that equal to zero, and zero equals M1 V1F plus M2 V2F. So if I set M1 V1F equal to negative M2 V2F, then that's going to be consistent with the negative velocity. Because the boater and the boat are initially at rest, the total initial momentum of the system is equal to zero. Therefore, the final momentum of the system must also be equal to zero. And that is going to be true. So this is true now. See, I got rid of the initial stuff. So now I have to solve for V2F. So I'm going to put the M1 V1F on the other side and then solve for V2F. And it's going to become a very basic equation. So that's M2 V2F equals negative M1 V1F. And then I'm going to divide both sides by M2, and I'm going to have that equation. Now, we know that V1F is going to be positive, so the only thing that can happen is that V2F will be negative, and that's going to be actually very true. So here's the equation, and then here are the instructions. Substitute the values into the equation and solve. I'm going to solve the equation, and by plugging in, I've got to plug in first, and there are the values, 76 kilograms times plus 2.5 divided by 45 is going to be negative 4.2 to the left. The negative sign for V2F indicates that the boat is moving to the left in the direction opposite the motion of the boater. A 63-kilogram astronaut is on a spacewalk when the tether line to the shuttle breaks. The astronaut is able to throw a spare 10-kilogram oxygen tank in the direction away from the shuttle with a speed of 12 meters per second, propelling the astronaut back to the shuttle. Assuming that the astronaut starts from rest with respect to the shuttle, find the astronaut's final speed with respect to the shuttle after the tank is thrown. First of all, this is going to answer that conceptual challenge of how to change direction in deep space. If the astronaut can do it by throwing an oxygen tank, a spaceship can easily change direction by using thrusters. Very, very straightforward. So this is going to be fairly quick. You got to label astronaut as one and the tank as two. So it's 63 kilograms is going to be the astronaut and 10 kilograms is going to be the tank. And there's my equation consistent with what I did before. That's just a larger version of the same equation. And again, there's astronaut is one, tank is two. And we're going to solve for V1F because we want to solve for the speed of the astronaut. And so we want to now plug in. The physics is basically done. And now what we want to do is plug in the values, which are given on the left. Some of it will be simplified because of the zero involved. And we're going to get negative 1.9 meters per second, which is fairly swift. An 85-kilogram fisherman jumps from a dock onto a 135-kilogram rowboat at rest on the west side of the dock. If the velocity of the fisherman is 4.30 meters per second to the west as he leaves the dock, what is the final velocity of the fisherman and the boat? So what do we have? We have the mass of the fisherman. We have the mass of the boat. We have the velocity of the fisherman, which is 4.3 meters per second to the west. What is the final velocity of the fisherman and the boat? So the fisherman and the boat are going to be together. So that's something that you have to come to grips with. You have to understand that the two masses are going to be together. It's an inelastic collision, which we'll look at next section. So the two masses combine into one giant mass. And you have to understand that by reading the problem. So picture what's happening. The fisherman is stepping into the boat, and the boat is on water. It's frictionless, essentially. So the boat and the fisherman are going to move as a result of his velocity of 4.3 meters per second, which is awfully fast to step into a boat. So the equation is going to be obvious. So there's no VF1 and VF2, it's just VF. So we have to isolate that VF. So you're going to divide the left side by M1 plus M2, that sum. So that's how you're going to get, I just reversed the equation. It's really the same thing. Both equations are basically the same. So I want to solve for VF. So I'm going to take the right side of the equation and divide it by the sum of the masses, M1 and M2. And so that's what I have. And now I'm going to plug in and solve. The zero helps things come out a little bit better, but it's negative 166 is going to be the final answer. And you don't really have to say negative and west. You say one or the other is fine, but having it both it's not wrong. Each croquet ball in a set has a mass of 0.5 kilograms. The green ball, traveling at 12 meters per second, strikes the blue ball, which is at rest. Assuming that the balls slide on a frictionless surface and all collisions are head-on, find the final speed of the blue ball in each of the following situations. The green ball stops moving after it strikes the blue ball. So it's going to transfer all of its momentum to the blue ball. So that I set up that equation, I plug in, and I grind it out. So why do I set up that equation? Well, try to figure that out, and we'll look at it a little bit more closely right now. The key is the one is going to be the green ball, and the two is going to be the blue ball. And you can see the V1F is final at 0 meters per second. So that's how that figures out. You know that all the momentums are equal. So the final velocity of the blue ball will be 12 meters per second. The green ball continues moving after the collision at 2.4 meters per second in the same direction. So here are the values, the new values, and that's going to be the equation. Now remember, all the masses are the same, so that helps. So mass 1 equals mass 2. So I can factor out the masses, and I'm left with a fairly simple equation, and it's going to be 12 minus 2.4, which will be 9.6 meters per second. A boy on a 2 kilogram skateboard initially at rest tosses a 8 kilogram jug of water in the forward direction. If the jug has a speed of 3 meters per second relative to the ground, and the boy and skateboard move in the opposite direction at 0.6 meters per second, find the boy's mass. So here are the values that we're going to be using. These are the givens. I have the M1 is 2 kilograms plus MB. M2 is 8 kilograms. That's the jug. So I have M2I is 0 meters per second. V2F is 3 meters per second. V1I is 0, and V1F is negative 0.6 meters per second. So here's my equation. I have MS, S is the skateboard, plus the MB, which is the boy, and then M2 is going to be the jug, the 8 kilogram jug. He tosses the jug, and so it lightens up as a result of that, and that has a velocity. And so I have MS plus MB, V1I. So that MS plus the MB, that's M1, essentially, together. Together, that is M1. So I plug into the equation, leaving MB out. So I have MB is what I have to solve for. I have 2 MBs, so I have to combine this in order to isolate MB. But you'll see that there's some strategic placements of 0, which will help isolate the MB. It's not nearly as difficult as it looks. So because of the zeros that are involved. So now it reduces to something a little bit nicer looking. So I'll make some combinations and eventually solve for simply MB. So I'll solve for MB, and MB is 38 kilograms. During the collision, the force exerted on each bumper car causes a change in momentum for each car. The total momentum is the same before and after the collision. During the collision, the force exerted on each bumper car causes a change in momentum for each car. the total momentum is the same before and after the collision. So here I have some examples of bumper cars before and after and the resulting vector changes. Newton's third law leads to conservation of momentum. Consider two isolated bumper cars, M1 and M2, before and after they collide. Before the collision, the velocities of the two bumper cars are V1 initial and V2 initial, respectively. After the collision, their velocities are V1 final and V2 final, respectively. The impulse momentum theorem, which is F delta T equals delta P, describes the change in momentum of one of the bumper cars. Applied to M1, the impulse momentum theorem gives the following. F1 delta T equals M1 times V1 final minus M1 V1 initial. Likewise, for M2, it gives the following. F2 delta T equals M2 V2 final minus M2 V2 initial. F1 is the force that M2 exerts on M1 during the collision, and F2 is the force that M1 exerts on M2 during the collision, as shown in Figure 8. Because the only forces acting in the collision are the forces the two bumper cars exert on each other, Newton's third law tells us that the force on M1 is equal to and opposite the force on M2. F1 equals negative F2. Additionally, the two forces act over the same time interval, delta T. Therefore, the force M2 exerts on M1 multiplied by the time interval is equal to the force M1 exerts on M2 multiplied by the time interval, or F1 delta T equals negative F2 delta T. That is, the impulse on M1 is equal to and opposite the impulse on M2. This relationship is true in every collision or interaction between two isolated objects. Because impulse is equal to the change in momentum, and the impulse on M1 is equal to and opposite the impulse on M2, the change in momentum of M1 is equal to and opposite the change in momentum of M2. This means that in every interaction between two isolated objects, the change in momentum of the first object is equal to and opposite the change in momentum of the second object. In equation form, this is expressed by the following equation. M1 V1 final minus M1 V1 initial equals negative quantity M2 V2 final minus M2 V2 initial. This equation means that if the momentum of one object increases after a collision, then the momentum of the other object in the situation must decrease by an equal amount. Next is a figure, figure 9. Total potential and kinetic energy must be taken into account in order to describe the total energy of the pendulum in a clock. Rearranging this equation gives the following equation for the conservation of momentum. M1 V1 initial plus M2 V2 initial equals M1 V1 final plus M2 V2 final. Forces in real collisions are not constant during the collisions. As mentioned in section 1, the forces involved in a collision are treated as though they are constant. In a real collision, however, the forces may vary in time in a complicated way. Figure 9 shows the forces acting during the collision of two bumper cars. At all times during the collision, the forces on the two cars at any instant during the collision are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. However, the magnitudes of the forces change throughout the collision, increasing, reaching a maximum, and then decreasing. When solving impulse problems, you should use the average force over the time of the collision as the value for force. Recall that the average velocity of an object undergoing a constant acceleration is equal to the constant velocity required for the object to travel the same displacement in the same time interval. The time averaged force during a collision is equal to the constant force required to cause the same change in momentum as the real changing force. Section review. Number one. A 44-kilogram student on inline skates is playing with a 22-kilogram exercise ball. Disregarding friction, explain what happens during the following situations. A. The student is holding the ball and both are at rest. The student then throws the ball horizontally, causing the student to glide back at 3.5 meters per second. Here are the givens. Here is the equation I'm solving for V2 final. So I want to rearrange my equation as indicated here and then solve through. I want to plug in my values. The zeros help reduce the complexity of the calculation, and I have the answer of plus 7 meters per second forward. B, explain what happens to the ball in part A in terms of the momentum of the student and the momentum of the ball. The momentum gained by the ball must be equal to and opposite the momentum gained by the student. C, the student is initially at rest. The student then catches the ball, which is initially moving to the right at 4.6 meters per second. So here's my givens, and I need to calculate my V final. So I rearrange for V final, I plug in, and I calculate plus 1.5 meters per second to the right. Explain what happens in part C in terms of the momentum of the student and the momentum of the ball. The student's initial momentum is zero. When the student catches the ball, some of the ball's momentum is transferred to the student. A boy stands at one end of a floating raft that is stationary relative to the shore. He then walks in a straight line to the opposite end of the raft, away from the shore. Does the raft move? Explain. Yes, the total initial momentum is zero, so the boy and the raft must move in opposite directions to conserve momentum. What is the total momentum of the boy and the raft before the boy walks across the raft? Well, it would be zero. Zero, zero, zero. What is the total momentum of the boy in the raft after the boy walks across the raft? It would be zero. High-speed stroboscopic photographs show the head of a 215-gram golf club traveling at 55 meters per second just before it strikes a 46-gram golf ball at rest on a tee. After the collision, the club travels in the same direction at 42 meters per second. Use the law of conservation momentum to find the speed of the golf ball just after impact. Most important first thing to do is to write down everything you have, write down all the facts, set up the conservation of momentum equation, and then plug in. What though are we looking for? You have to identify what's one, what's two, then plug in, and it's going to be 61.0 meters per second. Two isolated objects have a head-on collision. For each of the following questions, explain your answer. If you know the change in momentum of one object, can you find the change in momentum of the other object? Yes. The momentum lost by one object must equal the momentum gained by the other object. B. If you know the initial and final velocity of one object and the mass of the other object, do you have enough information to find the final velocity of the second object? No. V2 final also depends on V2 initial and M1. So you're going to need some more information. If you know the masses of both objects and the final velocities of both objects, do you have enough information to find the initial velocities of both objects? No. Using the conservation momentum, you could only find a relationship between V1 initial and V2 initial. Again, you would need the complete story, and you have to make sure that you have all the information you need before you even begin the problem. If you know the masses and initial velocities of both objects and the final velocity of one object, do you have enough information to find the final velocity of the other object? Yes. Using the conservation of momentum, you could substitute the given values and solve for V final. If you know the change in momentum of one object and the initial and final velocities of the other object, do you have enough information to find the mass of either object? Again, you need, if you have two objects, you need a minimum of M1, M2, and then the initial and final velocities of each. So that's for the complete picture. You can only have one variable to solve for if you have one equation. So the answer is, using the conservation of momentum, you could find M1 if V1 initial and V1 final are given, but you would need V2 initial and V2 final to find M2. Section 3, elastic and inelastic collisions. Four objectives. 1, identify different types of collisions. 2, determine the change in kinetic energy during perfectly inelastic collisions. 3, compare conservation of momentum and conservation of kinetic energy in perfectly inelastic and elastic collisions. Find the final velocity of an object in perfectly inelastic and elastic collisions. When one football player tackles another, they both continue to fall together. This is one familiar example of a perfectly inelastic collision. Collisions. As you go about your day-to-day activities, you probably witness many collisions without really thinking about them. In some collisions, two objects collide and stick together so that they travel together after the impact. An example of this action is a collision between football players during a tackle, as shown in Figure 10. In an isolated system, the two football players would both move together after the collision with a momentum equal to the sum of their momenta, plural of momentum, before collision. In other collisions, such as a collision between a tennis racket and tennis ball, two objects collide and bounce so that they move away with two different velocities. The total momentum remains constant in any type of collision. However, the total kinetic energy is generally not conserved in a collision because some kinetic energy is converted to internal energy when the objects deform. In this section, we will examine different types of collisions and determine whether kinetic energy is conserved in each type. We will primarily explore two extreme types of collisions, elastic and perfectly inelastic collisions. Perfectly inelastic collisions can be analyzed in terms of momentum. When two objects, such as two football players, collide and move together as one mass, the collision is called a perfectly inelastic collision. Likewise, if a meteorite collides head-on with Earth, it becomes buried in Earth, and the collision is perfectly inelastic. A perfectly inelastic collision is therefore defined as a collision in which two objects stick together after colliding. Figure 11. This is from Chapter 5. The total mechanical energy, potential energy plus kinetic energy, is conserved as the egg falls. The egg on the right will not break because of the increased time in the impulse decreases the corresponding force. This is Figure 11 from Chapter 6. The total momentum of the two cars before the collision, A, is the same as the total momentum of the two cars after the inelastic collision, B. Perfectly inelastic collisions are easy to analyze in terms of momentum because the objects become essentially one object after the collision. The final mass is equal to the combined masses of the colliding objects. The combination moves with a predictable velocity after the collision. Consider two cars of masses M1 and M2 moving with initial velocities of V1 initial and V2 initial along a straight line, as shown in Figure 11. The two cars stick together and move with some common velocity, V final, along the same line of motion after the collision. The total momentum of the two cars before the collision is equal to the total momentum of the two cars after the collision. This simplified version of the equation for conservation momentum is useful in analyzing perfectly inelastic collisions. When using this equation, it is important to pay attention to signs that indicate direction. In Figure 11, V1 initial has a positive value, M1 moving to the right, while V2 initial has a negative value, M2 moving to the left. Perfectly inelastic collisions, there is the equation. Notice M1 and M2 on the right are a sum. A 1850 kilogram luxury sedan stopped at a traffic light is struck from the rear by a compact car with a mass of 975 kilograms. The two cars become entangled as a result of the collision. If the compact car was moving at a velocity of 22 meters per second to the north before the collision, what is the velocity of the entangled mass after the collision? There's my given, there's my unknown. Use the equation for the perfectly inelastic collision. Notice that M1 and M2 are sum on the right side of the equation. Plug in the values for given and make sure that you solve for what it is you're looking for in terms of the unknown. So I believe it said that you're looking for the velocity of the mass of cars at the end of the accident. So in other words, you're solving for V final. So you're going to plug in to the equation that was derived for V final, and then you're going to put in your calculator and you're going to calculate the value. So plug in your numbers into your calculator and you're going to get plus 7.59 meters per second north. A 1500 kilogram car traveling at 15 meters per second to the south collides with a 4,500 kilogram truck that is initially at rest at a stoplight. The car and truck stick together and move together after the collision. What is the final velocity of the two vehicle mass? So again, you're going to use the same equation. Matter of fact, you can simplify things and just bring forward the final equation, plug in and calculate 3.75 meters per second. A grocery shopper tosses a 9-kilogram bag of rice into a stationary 8-kilogram grocery cart. The bag hits the cart with a horizontal speed of 5.5 meters per second towards the front of the cart. What is the final speed of the cart and bag? Same thing. You just bring forward the equation for V final that you used in problem one and the sample problem. Put down what you have that you're given. You're going to solve for VF. You're going to plug in and you're going to calculate. Very straightforward. 1.8 meters per second. A 1.5 times 10 to the 4th kilogram railroad car moving at 7 meters per second to the north collides with and sticks to another railway car of the same mass that is moving in the same direction at 1.5 meters per second. What is the velocity of the joined cars after the collision? Same exact problem. Plug in, solve for VF, do your calculator thing, and 4.25 meters per second, moving right along. A dry cleaner throws a 22-kilogram bag of laundry into a stationary 9-kilogram cart. The cart and laundry bag begin moving at 3 meters per second to the right. Find the velocity of the laundry bag before the collision. So make sure that you identify what M1, what M2, you know, what the 1 and the 2s are, and then solve for what you need to solve for. So in this case, the way we have it organized is we're solving for V1 initial. So solve your equation for V1 initial, plug in your values, bring them forward, plug in your values, and you get plus 4.2 meters per second or to the right. A 47.4 kilogram student runs down the sidewalk and jumps with a horizontal speed of 4.2 meters per second onto a stationary skateboard. The student and skateboard move down the sidewalk with a speed of 3.95 meters per second. Find the following: the mass of the skateboard. Again, identify what it is ones and twos represent, and then solve for what it is you identified as the mass of the skateboard. And in this case, the mass of the skateboard is, it's going to be M2. So we'll solve this equation for M2, rearrange everything, and solve everything for M2. And then we're going to isolate M2, and then plug in our values and solve for M2. You could plug in before you do the cap, before you do the rearranging, if you like. Same thing, as long as you get 3 kilograms as your answer. How fast the student would have to jump to have a final speed of 5 meters per second. Okay, the way I have this set up is the student is 1, so it would be V1 initial is what you're going to solve for in order to have the 5 meters per second as your final velocity. So you're going to solve for V1 initial. So divide both sides by the M1, get V1 initial, plug in, and crank it out. And you get, as your final answer, simplify, and boom, 5.34 meters per second. Students may think that elastic materials can undergo only elastic collisions. Consider a large brass bell with a clapper. The material, brass, is very elastic. After the collision, the bell continues to vibrate and gives off sound energy for a long time afterwards. The collision isn't elastic, even though the materials are. Inelastic materials undergo only inelastic collisions. Elastic materials may undergo either elastic or inelastic collisions. Kinetic energy is not conserved in inelastic collisions. In an inelastic collision, the total kinetic energy does not remain constant when the objects collide and stick together. Some of the kinetic energy is converted to sound energy and internal energy as the objects deform during the collision. The phenomena helps make sense of the special use of the words elastic and inelastic in physics. We normally think of elastic as referring to something that always returns to or keeps its original shape. In physics, an elastic material is one in which the work done to deform the material during a collision is equal to the work the material does to return to its original shape. During a collision, some of the work done on an inelastic material is converted to other forms of energy, such as heat and sound. The decrease in the total kinetic energy during an inelastic collision can be calculated by using the formula for kinetic energy as shown in sample problem F. It is important to remember that not all of the initial kinetic energy is necessarily lost in a perfectly inelastic collision. Two clay balls collide head-on in a perfectly inelastic collision. The first ball has a mass of 0.5 kilograms and an initial velocity of 4 meters per second to the right. The second ball has a mass of 0.25 kilograms and an initial velocity of 3 meters per second to the left. What is the decrease in kinetic energy during the collision? Here are the given quantities and the unknown, which is the change in kinetic energy. So I have M1, M2, V1 initial, V2 initial, and I need to somehow come up with the change in kinetic energy. Substitute the values into an equation and solve. First, calculate the final velocity, which will be used in the final kinetic energy equation. So if you look at the equation, I have all the ingredients except for one, and I can calculate one ingredient. That's what's allowed. So if you look at the equation, I have the full right side, and I have the M1 and M2, so I can solve for V final. Again, here are the known quantities, and then here is my equation. Now I'm going to plug into the equation. It is okay to get rid of the unit labels while you calculate. First, make sure that all of the units line up: mass in kilograms, force in newtons, velocity, meters per second, and only meters, seconds, and kilograms are used. So make sure that everything is lined up and everything is fine. You can get rid of the unit labels. You know, things make a little bit more sense and things are a little cleaner looking, and you can more easily see the values when you enter them into your calculator. So here are the numbers calculated, plus 1.7 to the right. Next, calculate the initial and final kinetic energies. I'm going to run through this very quickly. Here's the kinetic energy initial, and then here's the kinetic energy final, and here's the change in kinetic energy. So now I'll plug in the values that I have for each. Now, there is the initial kinetic energy, which is 5.12 joules, and then here's the final, and the values are listed there, and it's 1.05 joules. So I say 1.05 joules minus what was calculated for the initial. It's 5.12 joules, and then 1.05 joules. And I finally calculate the change in kinetic energy. And I'll just let that run. And the value is negative 4.07 joules. The negative sign indicates that kinetic energy is lost. A 0.25 kilogram arrow with a velocity of 12 meters per second to the west strikes and pierces the center of a 6.8 kilogram target. What is the final velocity of the combined mass? So it's going to be an inelastic collision. It's going to be a combined mass. So VF, this should be a familiar equation for you. Plug in and calculate, and you get negative 0.43 meters per second west. What is the decrease in kinetic energy during the collision? I have to do the same thing. There's going to be a lot of kinetic energy changes, so I'm just going to let that run very quickly through, and it's going to become very, very routine for you to check the kinetic energy as we go through these. So I'll let this run more quickly, plug in, calculate, initial, final, 2 seconds per slide. That's all I'm going to allow. It's going to, because it's becoming very routine, you can always put this on pause. But if you find a mistake, let me know. But this should be, you know, fairly well done. During practice, a student kicks a 0.4 kilogram soccer ball with a velocity of 8.5 meters per second to the south into a 0.15 kilogram bucket lying on its side. The bucket travels with the ball after the collision. What is the final velocity of the combined mass? Again, this one is the same thing. It should become very routine. Here are the values, and you're going to simply plug in and calculate. You know the equation for VF, so it's no surprise. Now you're going to double check and measure the decrease in kinetic energy during the collision. You have everything set up on the left. You just need to plug in and calculate everything. So on this particular one, you're going to get the change is going to be 3. It'll be 3. It'll be negative 3 joules. A 56 kilogram ice skater traveling at 4 meters per second to the north meets and joins hands with a 65 kilogram skater traveling at 12 meters per second in the opposite direction. Without rotating, the two skaters continue skating together with joined hands. What is the final velocity of the two skaters? Same idea, just list what I have, put down the equation, calculate negative 4.6 meters per second south, check the kinetic energy, and the next practice set is going to be just as routine. If this is becoming routine, then you are getting a good handle on this. Not a problem. Okay. Elastic collisions. When a player kicks a soccer ball, the collisions between the ball and the player's foot is much closer to elastic than the collisions we have studied so far. In this case, elastic means that the ball and the player's foot remain separate after the collision. In an elastic collision, two objects collide and return to their original shapes with no loss of total kinetic energy. Elastic collisions, a collision in which the total momentum and the total kinetic energy are conserved. After the collision, the two objects move separately. In an elastic collision, both the total momentum and the total kinetic energy are conserved. Most collisions are neither elastic nor perfectly inelastic. In the everyday world, most collisions are not perfectly inelastic. That is, colliding objects do not usually stick together and continue to move as one object. Most collisions are not elastic either. Even nearly elastic collisions, such as those between billiard balls or between a football player's foot and the ball, result in some decrease in kinetic energy. For example, A football deforms when it is kicked. During the deformation, some of the kinetic energy is converted to internal elastic potential energy. In most collisions, some of the kinetic energy is also converted into sound, such as the click of the billiard ball colliding. In fact, any collision that produces sound is not elastic. The sound signifies a decrease in kinetic energy. Elastic and perfectly inelastic collisions are limiting cases. Most collisions actually fall into a category between these two extremes. In this third category of collisions, called inelastic collisions, the colliding objects bounce and move separately after the collision, but the total kinetic energy decreases in the collision. For the problems in this book, we will consider all collisions in which the objects do not stick together to be elastic collisions. Therefore, we will assume that the total momentum and the total kinetic energy each will stay the same before and after collisions in all collisions that are not perfectly inelastic. In an elastic collision like the 1B, both objects return to their original shapes and move separately after the collision C. So we're going to be studying things that can be predicted. It's a lot easier. Figure 12 shows an elastic head-on collision between two soccer balls of equal mass. Assume, as in earlier examples, that the balls are isolated on a frictionless surface and that they do not rotate. The first ball is moving to the right when it collides with the second ball, which is moving to the left. When considered as a whole, the entire system has momentum to the left. After the elastic collision, the first ball moves to the left and the second ball moves to the right. The magnitude of the momentum of the first ball, which is now moving left, is greater than the magnitude of the momentum of the second ball, which is now moving to the right. The entire system still has momentum to the left, just as before the collision. Well, if that sounds confusing, read it again, and you can listen to me read it again. Another example of a nearly elastic collision is the collision between a golf ball and a club. After a golf club strikes a stationary golf ball, the golf ball moves at a very high speed in the same direction as the golf club. The golf club continues to move in the same direction, but its velocity decreases so that the momentum lost by the golf club is equal to and opposite the momentum gained by the golf ball. The total momentum is always constant throughout the collision. In addition, if the collision is perfectly elastic, the value of the total kinetic energy after the collision is equal to the value before the collision. Momentum and kinetic energy are conserved in an elastic collision. Here are the equations. I'm not going to read them out loud. Just make sure that you are familiar with them and you write them down and can use them. Remember that V is positive if an object moves to the right and negative if it moves to the left. So make sure you remember which is which. A 0.015 kilogram marble moves to the right at 0.225 meters per second, makes an elastic head-on collision with a 0.030 kilogram shooter marble moving to the left at 0.180 meters per second. After the collision, the smaller marble moves to the left at 0.315 meters per second. Assume that neither marble rotates before or after the collision and that both marbles are moving on a frictionless surface. What is the velocity of the 0.030 kilogram marble after the collision? Make sure that you draw a little map. That might help you tremendously. Here's what's given. Make sure that you have some kind of convention that you can write down where you know what one is, you know what two is, etc. So you're going to have a diagram. I wrote down a little bit of a diagram, and here it is, M1 to the right, M2 to the left. I included the velocity and the mass, and you're going to use this drawing to give you an idea. So intuitively, you could see that the larger marble might beat out the smaller marble, and you may have the total movement of both marbles to the left. So you want to choose an equation or situation. So you want to use the equation for the conservation of momentum to find the final velocity of M2, the 0.03 kilogram marble. So let's try to find out an equation and then solve for the final velocity of the M2 and see what happens. So I see where M2 is. Rearrange the equation to isolate the final velocity of M2. Not M2, we know what M2 is, but the final velocity, which is in which M2 will be traveling. So it's V2F, essentially. So here is you want to rearrange the equation. So you have V2F, and you want to plug in. You can plug in, you write down what you have, and you want to plug in your values. So the answer is 0.09 meters to the right. So I was wrong, but it's a very small velocity change, and it's going to be to the right. Okay, now, confirm your answer by making sure kinetic energy is also conserved using these values. And here are the values, and I'm going to come up with the equations for the initial kinetic energy and the final kinetic energy. I'm going to plug into the initial kinetic energy problem, generate a value for the initial kinetic energy, and then do the same thing for the final kinetic energy. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to determine if there was a change in kinetic energy, and there isn't. It's the same. So the change in kinetic energy, final minus initial, is zero. Energy is conserved. A 0.015 kilogram marble sliding to the right at 22.5 centimeters per second on a frictionless surface makes an elastic head-on collision with a 0.015 kilogram marble moving to the left at 18 centimeters per second. After the collision, the first marble moves to the left at 18.0 centimeters per second. Find the velocity of the second marble after the collision. So this is what you're given with the corrected velocities from centimeters to meters per second. And you're going to write down the equation, plug in, and now you're going to check the kinetic energy to see whether or not that's good. Now this is the initial kinetic energy, and then you have your final kinetic energy, and then you're going to do the change in kinetic energy. So you're going to do your initial kinetic energy first, you'll write that down, and then do the final kinetic energy, and then calculate the change in kinetic energy to see if it's elastic or possibly inelastic. So you see that it is perfectly elastic, and you have the delta KE of zero. A 16 kilogram canoe moving to the left at 12 meters per second makes an elastic head-on collision with a 14 kilogram raft moving to the right at 16 meters per second. After the collision, the raft moves to the left at 14.4 meters per second. Disregard any effects of the water. Find the velocity of the canoe after the collision. So here is what you have. This is what you want to solve for. You have it arranged. You're going to plug in and calculate. And that's your answer, 14.1 meters per second. Now, Verify your answer by calculating the total kinetic energy before and after the collision. So we're going to run through this quickly. This is your given, and then you're going to write down your equations for the initial and the final and calculate the difference. So here's your initial. Total initial, and then your final, and then calculate that, plug that in your calculator, and then do your change. You'll see that it is a zero change and that everything is elastic. A 4 kilogram bowling ball sliding to the right at 8 meters per second has an elastic head-on collision with another 4 kilogram bowling ball initially at rest. The first ball stops after the collision. Find the velocity of the second ball after the collision. I will speed this up a little bit. So you're going to find the velocity of the second ball after the collision, m1 equals m2. Write down the equations, plug in, and solve. Now you're going to check your kinetic energy to make sure that there is no loss of kinetic energy. And you get 130 initial, and you get 130 final, so it's going to be an elastic collision without loss of kinetic energy. A 25 kilogram bumper car moves to the right at 5 meters per second, overtakes and collides elastically with a 35 kilogram bumper car moving to the right. After the collision, the 25 kilogram bumper car slows to 1.5 meters per second to the right, and the 35 kilogram car moves at 4.5 meters per second to the right. Find the velocity of the 35 kilogram bumper car before the collision. So as these become more routine, I'm going to go through them more and more quickly. This one is going to go as swiftly as the last one. The first thing you're going to do is write down what you have, then write the equation, and then solve for what you need. And then plug in and come up with the answer. And then now put that in and check for your kinetic energy to see whether or not it is elastic. So your total initial is 382 joules. Now do your total final. And your total final is the same. So it's going to be an elastic collision, zero change. Okay, table two, very important. You have perfectly elastic, elastic, and inelastic. Those are your three types of collisions with what happens and other information, including drawings. Very, very descriptive. Please examine it very carefully and see if you can draw some conclusions. Give two examples of elastic collisions and two examples of perfectly inelastic collisions. For elastic collisions, answers may include billiard balls colliding, a soccer ball hitting a player's foot, or a tennis ball hitting a racket. For inelastic collisions, answers may include a person catching a ball, a meteorite hitting the earth, or two clay balls colliding. Trains coupling is a very good one. That's one of the best that I think you can use. A 95 kilogram fullback moving south with a speed of 5 meters per second has a perfectly inelastic collision with a 90 kilogram opponent running north at 3 meters per second. Calculate the velocity of the players just after the tackle. So fairly quick problem. You put down what you need, and you're going to calculate the final velocity. And that equation should be rather routine to you by this time. So you're going to plug in, come up with the answer. Now you're going to check your kinetic energy change. Here's your initial equation, your initial plug-in, your total kinetic energy initial, and then do your final. And your final is 112, and you're going to have a loss. You're going to have a loss of kinetic energy of negative 1481 joules. 2.4 kilogram soccer balls collide elastically in a head-on collision. The first ball starts at rest, and the second ball has a speed of 3.5 meters per second. After the collision, the second ball is at rest. What is the final speed of the first ball? Again, very quick. Here's what you need. Here's your equation. You can get rid of your masses because they both have the same mass. There's your final. Now check the kinetic energy. Here's what you have. Here's your initial. Here's your initial plug-in. Kinetic energy is zero. And then what is the kinetic energy of the second ball after the collision? Oh, that was just the first ball, and that's what it said. And so here's what you have. Here's your final. Here's the plug-in. You can see it's also zero. If two automobiles collide, they usually do not stick together. Does this mean the collision is elastic? No, otherwise it wouldn't have crumpled, essentially. No, some kinetic energy is converted to sound. A lot of kinetic energy is converted to sound. And some is converted to internal elastic potential energy as the cars deform. So the collision cannot be elastic. It's not elastic, not even close to elastic. A rubber ball collides elastically with the sidewalk. Does each object have the same kinetic energy after the collision as it had before the collision? Explain. No. If the collision is perfectly elastic, total kinetic energy is conserved, but each object can gain or lose kinetic energy. Does each object have the same momentum after the collision as it had before the collision? No. Total momentum is conserved, but each object can gain or lose momentum. Key ideas, momentum and impulse, section one. Momentum is a vector quantity defined as the product of an object's mass and velocity. A net external force applied constantly to an object for a certain time interval will cause a change in the object's momentum equal to the product of the force and the time interval during which the force acts. The product of the constant applied force and the time interval during which the force is applied is called the impulse of the force for the time interval. Section 2, conservation of momentum. In all interactions between isolated objects, momentum is conserved. In every interaction between two isolated objects, the change in momentum of the first object is equal to and opposite the change in momentum of the second object. In a perfectly inelastic collision, two objects stick together and move as one mass after the collision. Momentum is conserved, but kinetic energy is not conserved in a perfectly inelastic collision. In an inelastic collision, kinetic energy is converted to internal elastic potential energy when the objects deform. Some kinetic energy is also converted to sound energy and internal energy. Section 3, elastic and inelastic collisions continued. In an elastic collision, two objects return to their original shapes and move away from the collision separately. Both momentum and kinetic energy are conserved in an elastic collision. And finally, few collisions are elastic or perfectly inelastic. Here is the last table. It's a table of variable symbols, quantities, and units. Please look at it carefully. It will help you.